Hey now, Rodney R. Dixon here, and this is my review of the Samsung Galaxy Ace Android smartphone. The Samsung Galaxy Ace comes with the following. It comes with what they refer to as a travel charger, or a good old AC adapter. It's Samsung travel adapter model. Let's see if I could read this. ETA0U10JBE. As you can see, your standard travel charger adapter with the micro USB connector right there. It also comes with its own Samsung branded micro USB charge and data transfer cable, micro USB to USB. It is Samsung U2APCBU10BBEKD1BB05TSE. There you go. The phone comes, well, in my case, came with two faceplates. Came with this very cheap, flimsy one with this waffle pattern, I guess you could call it. Very cheap and flimsy, not impressive. And it came with this rather impressive, shiny, white backing with silver Samsung insignia, which is certainly much nicer. Gives the phone a nice two-tone look to it. Okay, so let's continue on with specifications of the phone. When referring to specifications of smartphones, I always recommend this site, geekaphone.com. That's geekaphone.com. About the Samsung Galaxy Ace, they had the following to say. Features Android 2.3 GingerBread. Features a 3.5-inch screen, 164 ppi, 480 by 320 resolution, capacitive touchscreen. It's 3.5G, HSDPA, 7.2 Mbps, and it's a 0.8 GHz or 800 MHz single-core processor. It was announced January 2011. It features a TFT LCD, 3.5-inch, resolution 480 by 320, capacitive, with multi-touch, and screen PPI is but 164. The weight is 113 grams, the thickness is 12 millimeters, the size is 59 by 112 by 11 millimeters. It has an 800 MHz processor, single core. The RAM is but 278 megs, which is low. The internal storage is only 158 megs, which is equally low. Of course, you can add micro SD or micro SDHC cards to expand the storage. GPS, it has assisted GPS, it has an accelerometer, and it has a compass. It has a 3.5 millimeter 1/8 inch stereo audio mini jack. It does have built-in FM radio. The camera is a 5 megapixel camera with an LED flash, and the format, when it comes to video, it could do 640 by 480 video at 24 frames a second. As mentioned, operating system is Google Android 2.3 GingerBread. Does support multitasking, does support the Android app market app store. The browser benchmark is 2095 ms. And contrary to what it says here, the phone does support Adobe Flash. The generation is 3.5G. The networks it supports is UMTS 0.384 Mbps, GSM 0.014 Mbps, Edge 0.384 Mbps, and HSDPA at 7.2 Mbps. The download speed is 2.26 Mbps, the upload speed is 0.56 Mbps, and the network latency is 200 ms. Wi-Fi standards it supports 802.11n, which is at 150 Mbps. It does support Wi-Fi hotspot. The Bluetooth standard is but 2.1. The talk time is reported to be 11.2 hours. Standby time, 26.7 days. The capacity of the battery is only 1,350 mAh. It is a removable battery of lithium-ion technology. So I'm just going to take it off my network real quick. I'm going to mute the screen. And we are going to go through the physical tour of the phone. Now, for those of you familiar with the Samsung Galaxy Geo, I strongly believe that the Samsung Galaxy Ace is the Well, the Samsung Galaxy Geo is the predecessor, and I strongly believe that the Samsung Galaxy Ace is the successor. I've owned 3 Samsung Galaxy Geos in my time, and obtaining the Samsung Galaxy Ace, the similarities are striking, almost. You have, as with the Samsung Galaxy Geo, 1 center home button and 2 tactile buttons in the same order as the Geo, mainly the menu button to the left and the back button to the right. As far as I'm concerned, this is the way it should always be on an Android smartphone. Other buttons are for the most part frivolous. This layout works beautifully. So you have these 3 buttons. As mentioned, these are tactile buttons, the menu and the back button, which light up when pressed. The home button is a physical button. As you can see, it has a silver rim around it. I can tell you, compared to the Samsung Galaxy Geo, I find this button harder to press and harder to get the sweet spot often. It's not as responsive as the Geo's was. Samsung branding at the top of the 3.5-inch screen. Chrome accent earpiece right up here. Here you have 2 light sensors. One's large enough that it almost looks like a secondary camera, but actually it's a light sensor. Around, very thinly around the edge, is a silver rim, a chromed rim, which, once again, is reminiscent of the Samsung Galaxy Geo, as well as the iPhone, the third generation iPhones. At the top, an improvement. They've changed the micro USB form factor jack. It now has a sliding snapping cover, as so. Here's the 3.5mm 1/8 inch stereo audio mini jack. On the left, you have a small rocker button for volume up, volume down. Here you have a porthole for either a wrist strap, a lanyard, a dragon, as we say in French, or one of those dangly things that people like to put on their phones. At the bottom is simply the microphone port. On the right side, you have the on-off sleep-wake button. You have a swing-open, easy-access micro USB slot. See this little door swings open. And the micro USB card is right there. It's spring mounted. You could eject it and lock it back in with the spring mount. Works quite well, same as the Samsung Galaxy Geo, all of this layout. On the back, once again, you have that that back plate, which I happen to like, the shiny white with the silver Samsung insignia. Here you have the opening for the loudspeaker, the 5-megapixel camera with LED flash. The finish, we've spoken of the white backing. The front is a piano black. And on the side, you have this finish it's hard to describe, but it's a gray that has metal flake accents in it. So it's a shiny metal flake gray. It's very nice. And there you go. Okay, moving on. Let's have a actual tour of the operating system. So the operating system used is Android 2.3. First thing I love about a Samsung variant smartphone is the ability to hold the home button and have a task manager right at your fingers. I have the browser open. I could end it, or I could end all. Boom, all gone. And for good measure, RAM, you know what? Using up 141 megs, that's too much. Clear memory. I'm now using 94.97 megs. Better. Okay, here we go. What I also like in a Samsung variant Android 2 device is this pull-down garage door notification area where you have the widget with the quick on-off functions of Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, GPS, the silent mode, and auto-rotation. I really like that. Also, when you hold the sleep-wake on-off button, you have access to silent mode, flight mode, and power-off. I found powering off the device, as with the Samsung Galaxy Geo, the Samsung Galaxy Exhibit 2 4G, known in Canada as the Samsung Galaxy W, and the Samsung Galaxy 3 Apollo GT-S5830D, that Samsung variant Android smartphones take a long time to shut down. I don't know why. They take their time. You generally, 45 seconds if your system is rather light, to over a minute if you have a lot of stuff on your system. Okay, so I completely customized the front end, the home screen. As you can see, it's now a black background with not very many icons. Let's go into an overview of... Oh, sorry, I shouldn't have shown that. Anyway, it doesn't matter. Whatever. An overview of the hardware. Very important to note, what I've noted is similar to the Samsung Galaxy Geo. I find the loudspeaker is underwhelming. The quality is... the sound output is thinny. It's not very loud. It's disappointing. Clock's a clock, won't go into it. Same thing with calendar, memo, you could write little memos to yourself. Music, the music player works very well. Camera. Let's cover the camera. As mentioned prior, the camera can take 640 by 480, 24 frames a second video, which is certainly a jump up from what the Samsung Galaxy Geo could. It also takes photos with flash. Hopefully I still have some photos on here. I don't think so. No, I had wiped the system. Otherwise, I'm afraid to start taking photos since my battery is low. I was testing it. Anyway. Whatever. Resolution. I could go up to 5 megapixel, 2560 by 1920. Image quality. I could put it to super fine. Okay. Could turn off the shutter sound, which I like. Could put on the flash. Here we go. Here's a sample image. You can see the flash is very bright. Forgot to mention, there is also an autofocus on the camera. There you go. There is a screenshot image. Hopefully I could take some video and things won't get too difficult. Resolution, 640 by 480. Once again, super fine. Okay. Okay. Here's an example of video I am taking on the Samsung Galaxy Ace. Should give you an idea of what the loudspeaker sounds like. And video playback.
Here's an example of video I am taking on the Samsung Galaxy Ace.
As it turns out, the loudspeaker doesn't do too bad on video you take on the phone. Anyway, both are very satisfying as far as a camera for the budget of this device. Gallery, of course, is your photo gallery and your video gallery. FM radio. FM radio, right now it won't work, but the FM radio is really interesting. First off, in order to use it, you must turn off airplane mode. You can't have airplane mode engaged. However, the frequency can be altered with this jog wheel. You also have an auto scan that you could use with these guys. And not only can you, I'm going to use the French term Saint-Denis, not only can you, I don't know how you'd say that in English, lock on to the frequency of the radio station you wish to, but it also displays information in a PDT form of what the radio station is transmitting. So for example, it would display the station name, the logo of the station, not the logo, excuse me, the what's it called? I'm drawing a blank. The slogan of the station, the catchphrase, if you will. It'll also display certain information such as what song is playing, what's the temperature where you are, and so on and so forth. Very good. All sure I couldn't get to work, I won't go into it. Internet. It would help if I was online. Sorry about that. As it turns out, on most Android smartphones, when you turn on the FM radio, it tries to kill your Wi-Fi. Okay, so, as mentioned prior, the device does support the browser for the most part. As you saw, I was navigating Geekaphone before. It works well. The phone does support Adobe Flash. However, here's the kicker. Adobe Flash wouldn't work on streaming video websites from national broadcasters. It's weird. For example, I tried watch.ctv.ca. No dice. It kept on telling me Adobe Flash Player was required. I tried globaltv.com, same thing, flash players required. However, I tried musicplus.com. Now, what Music Plus is, it's the francophone equivalent to Much Music in Canada or MTV in the States. And it worked fine. Video played nice. You know what? Maybe I could show you that. Hopefully it doesn't... bear with me. Hopefully it doesn't play any of the audio over the loudspeaker. I know this is quite the task right now. I can tell you as far as Wi-Fi reception. Now, I've noticed the same thing in my Samsung Galaxy Geo. I find Wi-Fi reception is just poor. It's always poor. It's always low. It's at best, I get one bar. I get two bars if I'm right next to my router. It's disappointing. Now, here's the question. Is it really poor, or is it just a matter of... how can I put that? Is it really poor, or is it just a matter of the meter being set to only accept extremely strong signals as having many bars? I'm not sure. I haven't lost connections, just out of the blue, so that's fine. But as you can tell, often I have no bars. I just have no Wi-Fi reception, and that is disappointing. Just waiting to show you an example of flash playback. Of course, if you're familiar with my videos that I shoot, for the most part I'm going to mute sound, so you won't get a sense of how the phone processes video in sync with audio, but I can assure you that it does very well, at least on musicplus.com. As mentioned prior, sites like watch.ctv.ca and globaltv.com. No dice, nothing doing. Come on. It does take time for, in this case, things to load. You're kidding me. I chose a video that just won't show up right now? Oh, come on. This always seems to happen. When I'm doing a live video, or a recording, everything always takes its jolly sweet time to load buttons like share and tweet. Oh boy. Come on. Oh, now Facebook and Google Plus. Oh, these are all very important. Come on, really? You won't show it to me? Okay. I'll try one last video. If it doesn't work, then you'll just have to take my word for it. I don't want to start showing dudes who don't necessarily want to be here on my video. I can't say that these guys do either, but they broadcast live, so. Now, the video I'm dialing up right now, I had watched prior on this phone, so. There shouldn't be issue. Here we go. Now we're in the money. Still loading. Come on. It should be noted that this website does encode their website in one form. Not ringer volume. Oh, I hate that. I hate that you can't adjust media playback until the media starts playing back. Loading video. Okay, luckily there was no licensed music there. But that gives you an idea of the quality. Right now it's downscaling to match my buffer speed and my network speed. My network's always, you know, all gummed up at night. But for the most part, it works really well, and I am impressed with it. So that was a lot of work to see 3 seconds of video. Sorry about that. Okay, Google Play Store works as intended. Gmail, I don't use. Email. Can I dial up email real quick? The email browser is actually really, really Impressive. Why is the email browser so impressive? Well, HTML email, you could actually zoom out of really easy and zoom into, once again, very easy. Not all email browsers are this friendly. And as you can see, the speed of the processing of the HTML, as well as the scrolling, is just really, really good and really, really impressive. So that I was impressed with. Moving on. Oh, important to note, the email client could not accept my Yahoo Mail credentials on the fly. I actually had to go on the Yahoo Help website and get the actual SMTP and the actual addresses for each portion to obtain Yahoo Mail. It was like a form to fill out with maybe 7 or 8 entries. But once you configure it, it works real nice. Google search, who cares? Maps. Maps I've played with quite a bit, especially regarding the navigate functionality. Unfortunately, this phone has two things that I'm not a fan of. Essentially, maps only cache when you are plugged in to a charger. They don't just cache on their own. Sorry, I'm just turning on wireless networks and GPS satellites. Even though it's completely pointless considering I'm in a basement, I'll never get GPS satellites. But, anywho. Gamma. Waiting for location. Okay. Can I clear this? Oh, clear map. Thank you. Don't give me that temporarily unavailable. Anyway, it doesn't matter. Here, we'll look up here in Muskush. Okay, so Google Maps functions rather well when it comes to the interface and moving about the map. The cache settings, as mentioned. No, I'm sorry. On this phone, prefetch on mobile. It'll prefetch even if you're not charging, so that's a plus. I apologize. I misjudged. There's also the option of Labs precache map area, which is great. Essentially, the way it works is you hold your finger on any point, loads an address, and then you could elect to precache a map area, and what it will do is it will precache a large area. So we're talking 10 miles, a 10-mile area of where you are highlighting. And from there, you can use these maps offline when you don't have a data network connection. Of course, there's a compass, which is great, especially when you're using the device to navigate on a map. Let's go somewhere, shall we? Directions. We will go to, where will we go? Villeray. Let's go to Villeray. There we go. That's how you get to Villeray. Of course, you have your turn-by-turn list. That's good. You can route options, avoid highways, avoid tolls. In my case, avoiding tolls whenever I'm going to the east is necessary. And of course, if I tap on navigate, it'll open up the GPS navigation portion of Google Maps. Unfortunately, the way the navigate portion of Google Maps works on this phone is first it must establish a GPS connection before it'll download your map data, which is terribly frustrating. So you have to be at a spot where your phone will get A, clear view of the sky to see the satellites, and B, access to a data network source, such as your Wi-Fi, in order to then download the maps and navigation. I've learned today two things. I first mapped out a route in Google Maps, which started at a point that was not where I was, and ended at another point where I was not. I got my route just fine, but then when I tapped navigate, guess what it did? It said, no, you don't want to navigate from where you stated, you want to navigate from where you are. That was unfortunate. Also, in my navigate routes, as I showed you, I had to avoid tolls because Google Maps loves to send me on a toll bridge because, oh, you could save 5 minutes. Yeah, but it's going to cost me like $10 each passage. It's ridiculous. Save 5 minutes. It's obscene. But when I had my alternate route that didn't begin where I was and I then navigated it, it changed all my directions and decided, you know what? No. You're going to take the toll bridge. I didn't take the toll bridge, so guess what? After I bypassed the toll bridge, what it then did is it decided, okay, well, we'll reroute you to get back onto toll bridge. And once it was hopeless, once I was way off the beaten path for it, it just gave up. And what it did was it kept the toll bridge in view and it kept on zooming out the map until the map kind of looked like this. The toll bridge was like up here and I was down here. It was ridiculous. I also learned that since I have this phone registered on two different Wi-Fis, if you go to a different Wi-Fi that you're registered on and you leave Wi-Fi enabled, it'll reconnect and it'll eventually reroute you if your navigate portion is completely off the path in which you want to go. Let's get some street view so you can see how that works. What's new in street view? Loading, there you go. Whoa, looking up at the sky. Here we go, this is the way street view looks. I don't think street view is terribly good looking on this phone, but that does not mean that it is not efficient. It works rather well, as you can see. Here we go, let's get Pegman going. Go, Pegman! Whoop. And there you go. Street view works rather well. Okay, let me try to kill some things. Unfortunately, Maps is one of those tricky buggers that you could never kill it out of memory using a memory manager. You always got to go into settings, go into applications, running. Even this doesn't work, tell you the truth. Kind of wasting my time. Maps, stop, email, stop, Samsung Home, stop. Okay. Okay. Let's get rid of location and security. I don't need it right now. And it's drinking the precious little battery I have left. All right, Social Hub. What Social Hub will do is it'll group your email and your SMS messaging, your SMS text messaging, into one Social Hub that'll notify you when you get either new email or a new SMS text message, and you could reply to either. Settings is settings. YouTube. Why is YouTube on second page? Who knows? Let's see YouTube. Loading. I find the video playback on this phone is not... I mean, it's fine. It's a little pixelated, so it's a little fuzzy. But it does... It does play smoothly, and it does play in sync. Once again, battling with my network. Here we go.
It's GT-S5830D, as issued by Koodo Mobile here in Canada. I should begin with a retraction. Originally, when I was
Well, there you go. You also have an idea of what the audio sounds like. This was a video recorded on the same camera that I'm recording right now, so that gives you an idea. Moving on, Google Talk, I don't use it. Latitude, I don't tell people where I am. Voice search, don't care. Navigation, I talk about. Places, it'll tell me where, restaurants are around and whatnot. News and weather, it's the news and weather that gives you, well, what the heck. It's easier to just show it. News and weather, sadly, is not too impressive, I gotta say. It's the news and weather that gives you a very simple breakdown of the weather based on the weather network, which, once again, I'm not a fan of. And as far as news, it doesn't give you actual synopses. It doesn't give you synopsis, a brief version of the story. It only gives you a headline, and when you tap on any headline, it'll then bring you to a website. So, very disappointing. And right now, it's not loading, and I don't want to wait for it, so forget it. My files, you could actually see the files on your device, which is kind of fun. See? That's neat, and you can do things like delete, move, copy, rename, and details. That's fun. Think Free Office, apparently you can, You could do things like open up documents. I thought you can create documents, but I don't see a way to do so. So apparently, Microsoft Office compatible Office Suite. Apparently it'll open up documents. I don't know if you could edit them. I didn't really play with it. Calculator. Samsung apps requires a SIM card and mobile network service, so can't help you there. Voice recorder. Let's see how well voice recorder performs. If I remember right, it's not terribly impressive. There's no volume units or anything of that nature.
Voice recorder. Let's see how well voice recorder...
There you go. It's loud, but it's muddy. Not impressive. Task manager, I showed you. And them all. Clear memory. Good, good. Where was I? Download shows your downloads. Fongo is an app I installed. It's a phone app, so you can make phone calls. It works rather well regarding phone calls. You can hear a party just fine. The other party can hear you just fine. It's fairly well. Text Plus, SMS texting app, works just great. SMSing was not an issue at all. And that's all on the phone. Let's cover the keyboard. The keyboard is a Samsung variant keyboard. Now, I happen to love the Samsung variant keyboards. It's the size of the keys, the way the keys are placed. It generally, for the most part, equals simple accuracy. Right now, I'm just tapping anything. But it's generally, for the most part, very much accurate, both in portrait and landscape view. Of course, there is also the voice recognition, but I can't seem to do it here. Why is that? Let's make an SMS. New message. Tap to compose. Here we go. Hey there, buddy. I haven't talked to you in a long while. How have you been? ? There you go. It didn't get the have, but still pretty good. The voice detection on this phone is very good. But as you heard with the recording when it came to the video, the microphone on the device is very, very good. It's very, it really picks up a crisp recording, so it is very good. And there you go. What can I say more about the phone? Just to recap, I didn't like the fact that Wi-Fi reception seems to always be low. Battery. My battery right now is so low because, as I've learned, when you have the screen pumped up to the max brightness, you have your GPS satellites on, you have your use wireless networks for GPS positioning on, and you have Google Maps Navigate going and all that, actually the phone drinks juice. It's pretty remarkable. I had a full charge. I used through 45 minutes of driving. I lost 3/4 of my battery using all of those things. But once again, important to mention that, of course, I had brightness jacked all the way to the max. And I had the wireless networks and use GPS satellites going, and I was using the Google Maps Navigate functionality. So that could have really set a damper on battery usage, but that surprised me. I expected it to be to work much better than that, but hey, what can you do? Also, what else can I say about the phone? The phone is, for the most part, light. I really like the dimensions. The dimensions ensure that it fits within an iPhone 4 case, if you have an iPhone 4 case, which is nice. The layout of the buttons, I used to have an issue with this on-off sleep-wake button being here, because sometimes you tap it by accident. But as it turns out, I guess after owning 3 Samsung Galaxy Geos, I got accustomed to it being here, so I never tap it by accident anymore. I love the access to the micro SD card, how it's so simple and easy with this little protective door, snap in, snap out. So many phones, you have to take apart the whole back housing. Sometimes you even have to remove the battery. That's annoying. The back housing, for the most part, removed really nice, really easy. Overall, it's for the price that you pay for the phone, it's a good phone. Why is it a good phone? Mainly because it's a Samsung phone and because of all the refinements and the actual Samsung variant Android operating system that's on here. If you were dealing with, you know, like an LG or what have you, the phone wouldn't be nearly as impressive. Believe it or not, the 480x320 resolution didn't faze me. The 3.5-inch screen really made for a good viewing surface and a good navigation surface. I found the images, for the most part, crisp. I found navigation throughout the phone, especially on things like web browser and what have you, worked very well. Task management worked well, despite the limited memory on the phone. And overall, yeah, there you go. I don't have much more to say. It is a, for the price, it is a nice piece of hardware, especially considering the, in regards to the Samsung Galaxy Geo. If you're a fan of the Samsung Galaxy Geo, the Samsung Galaxy Ace is practically the, I neglect to say evolution, because not many things have evolved aside from the size of the screen, the camera with flash, and the ability to capture video with it. Oh, of course, Adobe Flash support, which the Geo didn't have. But yeah, other than that, it's an impressive phone. I have to say, it works really well. And maybe as a starter Android phone, it's a good choice. Right now, I've moved up to, obviously, more expensive, more fancy phones, so for me, it's a little on the limited side. But nonetheless, its dimensions, its size, and its performance are all pretty impressive for an 800 megahertz device. Well, there you go. I'll leave you with that. I hope this information helps, and as usual, all the best.